This show is part of the RetroZap.com podcast network.
Hi, this is Vanessa Marshall, voice of Hera and Rook Cast, and you're listening to Dennis and Jay on Podcast Stardust. Their behavior is continually unexpected.
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Hello, I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And welcome to this fully armed and operational edition of Podcast Stardust. This is a galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. Before we get to this week's discussion of Star Wars Rebels, Jay, where can we be found around the internet?
We can be found on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And we can be reached by email at podcaststardust@retrozap.com.
All right, so this week we are discussing the 7th episode of Season 1 of Rebels, and this is Out of Darkness. First up, we need to remind everyone that this is a full spoiler discussion. So if you haven't seen these and you don't want to be spoiled, then go check those out and then come back. But with that having been said, Jay, do you want to go ahead and give us a summary of this episode?
Absolutely. When Sabine gets frustrated about not getting all the details concerning missions from Hera's contact in the rebellion, Fulcrum, she insists on joining Hera on her next mission. After they arrive on Fort Anaxes, a base abandoned after the Clone Wars, local creatures called Fearnox begin hunting them as they retrieve supplies left behind by Fulcrum. However, they cannot leave the planet because Zeb, Ezra, and Chopper failed to fix a fuel leak caused by an impact during their last mission. While Sabine and Hera wait for Kanan and the rest of the crew to arrive with the Ghost, they set up traps for the Fearnox and fight for their lives. Just as they are about to be overrun, the Ghost arrives and they safely get off planet. As the episode ends, Hera confides in Sabine that they do trust her, but they can't reveal all the Rebel secrets to her just yet. In response, Sabine says she will try to trust Hera and the crew.
Yeah, it's a tidy episode, but it's enjoyable. And I had a lot of fun with this one, and it was great to see Hera get as much action as she did. Because in a lot of the previous episodes, as the pilot of the crew, she's usually the one that stays behind with the Ghost while everyone else infiltrates the Star Destroyer or the base or whatever they may be. But she really got to be front and center for this one, and I love that.
Right, and it just shows the way that she's able to think on her feet and able to take charge of the situation. And we still get that feeling of she is the mom, you know, especially when Ezra and Zeb and Chopper are trying to figure out what's going on. And she's like, okay, you've got until the next mission to figure it out. And that's not long. I'm leaving soon. And just like, all right, kids, clean up your mess, you know, kind of a thing. So, but yeah, there's a lot to this episode that, you know, once I sat down and really thought about it, are very far reaching. You know, the whole idea of Fulcrum, and we even see the markings on the one box, and Hera kind of rubs her thumb, I think, across the markings themselves. And the Fearnox, which we see in other parts of Star Wars. And just there's just so much about this that I love.
Right. And correct me if I'm wrong, but this is really where we got introduced to the idea of Fulcrum, was this episode, was it not?
Yes. I mean, you know, now that we've been reviewing these, this is the first time that we've heard that particular name or that particular title.
Yeah, and we know from other sources afterwards that Fulcrum was a name that got adopted by lots of Rebel operatives, which we'll find out over the course of Rebels itself. And then people like Cassian Andor used it as well as part of the recruitment efforts for the Rebellion and a way of getting information or transmitting information. So we know Wedge ran into a Fulcrum from some tie-in material, but it was unclear at the time which Fulcrum that was. Mm-hmm. And this was something that really set off the Star Wars community early on, because we did see those markings on the crate that looked like Ahsoka's markings. And that speculation started running rampant at that time, to the extent that people were trying to take the voice that Fulcrum used and unalter it to figure out who was underneath.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And I love the whole idea of just using the word fulcrum too, because it's a tipping point. And that's exactly, you know, or a base point for, you know, an essential role kind of a thing. And that's exactly what these fulcrum do.
Right. But this whole adventure and story gets started because it's Hera, Sabine, and Ezra in the Phantom, not the ghost. And they are trying to get back from a mission and they're being pursued by Ties. And Sabine is loudly complaining that the information that they got from this Fulcrum character didn't mention the strength of the forces that they're going to be encountering. And so when they finally escape from the Ties, they've incurred a little bit of damage, including this gash that creates the fuel leak. And then Sabine starts voicing these complaints that she doesn't like being left out in the dark. She doesn't like being in the cold on what's going on. She wants to know what their missions are about, who they're working for, who they're getting these from. Because as we learn, she had these type of problems when she was at the Imperial Academy on Mandalore.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And so she's got a little PTSD from that, you know, to say the least, I think. And she's just got some trust issues there. But I have to say real quickly, that whole scene with them in the Phantom just reminds me of like the mom trying to navigate rush hour traffic and the two kids are in the backseat fighting, you know, and fighting with mom, fighting with each other, trying to, you know, you know, bicker and fight. But yeah, so Sabine definitely does have those trust issues, but she was smart enough to be able to see where things were leading. And that's why she left. And that's also what she was telling Hera too, you know, that's why I left. So it was almost like, I don't want to call it a veiled threat in a way, but, you know, basically putting it out there to Hera that, you know, I could leave if I'm not trusted because I need to know what's going on.
Yeah, this is the second hint that we've had about her past in the series, because early on, it was either in the first or second episode of the two-part introduction. It tells Ezra that basically the Empire is what happened to her. And just like it happened to Zeb and it happened to Kanan and everybody else. And that's why they've come together as this crew. And now she's going on about some sort of a trust issue that occurred at the Academy. And then as the series progresses, we get more of those hints until we're just flat out told what the inciting events were that caused her to, I'm not sure if defect is quite the right word or not, from the Imperial Academy and then strike out on her own and ultimately brought her into contact with Kanan and Hera and this crew. But I like what you said about the kids in the back seat there, because they already at least want to have someone trying to interfere with your driving is when you're being pursued by TIE fighters. So don't make me turn around. Well, yeah, sure. Do that. We're being pursued. So, and then of course, when they get back to the ghost, as you mentioned, Hera sets Zeb, Ezra, and Chopper to fixing the Phantom. And part of that is because the three of them had been going at each other kind of in Three Stooge fashion. And I hesitate to say it that way because as you and I have talked in the past, there is a certain baseline for Star Wars humor. And I don't feel like this fell below that. I feel like it was kind of within that border area, but it starts off with Ezra and Chopper going after each other. And then Zeb is trying to enjoy his space waffles. Of all things.
That they got on their last supply run.
Right. And then
they lost them all.
Exactly. And then Ezra and Chopper ruin his breakfast. And then you know, they end up at Hera's feet. And then she assigns them that mission. But they're still going after each other while they're doing the repairs. And although they run the diagnostic, they leave before they can actually read that. And had they done so, they might have noticed that they didn't actually get the fuel leak fixed.
Right. Yeah. And Ezra riding Chopper almost like a rodeo, you know, he was on a bull because he had his one arm up in the air and then Chopper's just spinning around and spinning around. But I love that. That was so funny when Zeb was sitting there like wafting the smell from his space waffles. And then, yep, here comes Ezra and Chopper ruining the whole thing.
Yeah. You just knew what was coming there. Mm-hmm. So basically Sabine, I wouldn't call it an ultimatum, but she doesn't really give Hera a choice that she's coming along on this next mission that they're going to get from Fulcrum. And she's right there in the cockpit when they get the message from Fulcrum. And she just blurts out this outburst that, you know, oh, great, stick around. We'll have a conversation. And, you know, Hera ends up reprimanding later. It's like, I don't appreciate that type of outburst. And then Sabine snaps right back. Well, I don't appreciate being left in the dark. And so we have this ongoing trust theme that we've been talking about. So that's how they end up at Fort Anaxes. which we've most recently seen in the Clone Wars. Mm-hmm. In Rebels, it's floating around on an asteroid, in an asteroid field. And Hera explains that this base was abandoned shortly after the Clone Wars. Well, when we saw it in the Clone Wars was during the Bad Batch episodes in this last season, and the planet was still intact at the
yes.
time.
Yes. Yeah. And the whole thing with Trench and everything. And that's just, it's so great to be able once again to tie things together that we know and almost like, oh yeah, yeah, yeah. I know this. Mm-hmm. And you know, it's just, it's fun. I love it.
Right. And the base is still laid out all the same as mm-hmm. it was in the Clone Wars. Now I'm wondering what happened. I mean, that was a rough 20 years or whatever yeah. it was that for that planet. And was perhaps the bombs that Trench left behind not ever actually mm-hmm. removed and they detonated that caused this problem? I mean, all we can do is speculate, but I'm a little curious as to what ultimately happened to Anaxes to cause this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm thinking it was the bombs because he had them kind of hidden all over the shipyards. And then it just the blowing up of that and the explosion of that probably just sent the debris into the atmosphere and then we're just suspended there.
Right. But it was really pretty cool. So they find the crates that are been they find the crates that have been left behind by Fulcrum, including one that's got the markings that look remarkably like Ahsoka's markings, which again got everybody stirred up. And I gotta admit, it was pretty cool to see that back in the day. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And Hera says to Sabine, "I got this one." And so I'm curious. I'd love to know what was in that crate.
Right.
And why it was that Hera was so eager not to let Sabine even touch it, to move it. I mean, was it that delicate of a thing, or was there something on that crate that was such an obvious giveaway that Sabine couldn't see at the time? What was your thought on that?
Well, the only thing I could think was that maybe somehow Sabine could have recognized the symbol. And so in my mind, I was thinking that maybe Hera was taking no chances on that particular crate, but mm-hmm. I don't know. But you know, talking about Fulcrum too, just to back up just a second, did you hear like when they were talking to Fulcrum and obviously the voice was disguised and, you know, very mutilated in that. And of course Sabine's trying to talk to Fulcrum as well. Did you hear Ashley's voice in there now knowing, you know, what we know?
Well, I was trying to remember this last time when I watched the episode. I do believe they actually used Ashley Eckstein to record that. But when people started getting wise to that, the next time we hear Fulcrum's voice, they used a different actress to do it. And so I that's my memory of what happened, but I couldn't remember if that was actually the case. But it was a stretch. They have enough static and distortion going on there that it didn't even necessarily have, how do I put this? Maybe the same cadence as what you would usually hear with Ahsoka. Mm-hmm. It was, maybe the words were slightly elongated or something, but they did a pretty good job disguising it, at least I thought. How about you?
Oh yeah, I do. I definitely. But, you know, of course, maybe it's just me reading into it, knowing that we've got Ahsoka coming here. But I think, was it that her voice was not, it just wasn't at all in the credits as far as saying Ashley Eckstein, because I was trying to remember if there was anything, you know, speculation when we were all trying to figure out who this was.
No, she wasn't in the credits.
She was even credited. Yeah, no. I didn't think that she was, because I remember doing that myself, was trying to go back in some of these and looking at credits to see. But I know that there was someone on Twitter at the time, I think it was, had talked about how on, you know, some of the different kinds of countries that would translate into their languages, they would list the voice actors. Mm-hmm. And so that's how they figured it out. I don't think it was from this episode necessarily, but one in the future.
Right. And like I said, I do know they used a different actress to disguise who was doing it in a future mm-hmm. episode. And before we get the ultimate reveal that Fulcrum is Ahsoka, that's coming mm-hmm. up. And at any rate, so they've been there, they get these crates, and they notice a couple have been dragged off kind of into the cave region of the base, the interior, because this base backs up against the side of a cliff. And mm-hmm. so they go in there and they see Clone Wars era wreckage, including a troop transport. And then that's when the Fear Knocks start to reveal themselves. And they quickly learn that the Furnox can't come out into the sunlight. The only mm-hmm. problem they've got is that the asteroids that are in the belt that are around them keep blocking the sun. And so they realize that they are going to have to buy themselves some time until Kanan and the rest of the Spectre squadron can get there to help them out. It was pretty cool the way they handled this. It was a bit kind of like a video game, the way they talked about waves, you know, wave one, wave two, wave three,
yeah.
and setting up all the fuel. Sabine gets the idea to take these drums of, what does she call it? Rhydonium, which mm-hmm. apparently first appeared in the Clone Wars episodes that dealt with Gregor. And as the Furnox would swarm to an area, they'd blow up the fuel and then that would kind of wear them down. And it works for a time, and they ultimately have to retreat to the top of the Phantom, and they're out of fuel tanks to blow up and then fight off the Furnox until the Ghost can get there. But it was just a cool sequence with those two working together and coordinating their attacks. And they've got, you know, they're back to back and they're circling around to shoot off Furnox as they get close. And I really like the way that all came together.
Oh yeah. They definitely made a great team for sure. And the one thing that kind of looms in my brain a little bit too, was Hera mentioning the fact that some of the cartons were scraped across the ground. Like, why wouldn't they use the anti-grav? So mm-hmm. do you think it was the Furnox trying to, you know, get at whatever was inside of them, which also makes me wonder, okay, well, what's inside of them?
Yeah, I took it that there was at least some food in some of these, and that's what the Furnox were after, and they dragged them in and slashed them open. And yes, because that was part of the clue that this wasn't just a sentient that moved the crates, that something else was going on there. Mm-hmm. And this is not the last we'll see of the Furnox either. And we find out a little bit more about them in an upcoming episode. But they kind of had a alien vibe from the Aliens franchise a little bit with the way that they swarmed in the dark and stuff. You know, they didn't have some of the more grotesque features of the aliens, but they were something to reckon with.
Yes, definitely. And the only way that, like you said, that they were going to get rid of them was by using that rhydonium. And rhydonium always reminded me of mercury because it was described as like this silvery, almost like a gel kind of a thing, but it was really potent and toxic to the skin. Mm-hmm. So yeah, but that's, I like the way that they work together on that whole sequence. And like you said, wave one, wave two, and they're just spot on with their shooting. So that's definitely something that Sabine did not learn at the Imperial Academy.
Right. I also liked the earlier sequence where when they noticed they had the fuel problem and that they were going to have to buy themselves some time, and they contact the Ghost and they get held of Zeb, and you know, she asks him about, you know, did you run the diagnostic? And it occurs to him, yeah, we did, but we never checked the results. And so yeah. he wanders up there, reports, he's like, you may have a problem with a fuel leak. And she's like, yeah, small problem. It was the voice acting that Vanessa Marshall did there. If her kind of incredulous response was spot on. It was absolutely perfect for that mm-hmm. moment there. And then, of course, when the Ghost does show up to rescue them, Ezra goes charging off into battle like he always does and gets himself into more trouble than Hera and Sabine were in, because he's about to become the snack for one of these Furnox before Sabine blasts it off him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's trying to use his little... Oh, what's that thing called? I can't even think of it. The slingshot, yes.
Yeah.
To try to get them away. And it's not really having much of an effect.
Right. And this is also the phase where he's still flirting with Sabine an awful lot. And so when they get back in the ship, finally, he says something to the effect of like, hey, thanks for saving my life back there. And she snaps back right away. Hey, don't read too much into it. Mm-hmm. It's just that, you know, you're part of the team, but, you know, cool your jets there.
Right. Right.
What did you think about those two? I mean, it's a relationship that they kind of had Ezra flirting with her for a number of episodes, but it pretty much is done with by the end of this first season, if not earlier.
It is. And I think, you know, Ezra's just, he's a typical teenage boy and Sabine is beautiful. So, mm-hmm. you know, he's just kind of testing the waters a little bit. And Sabine is just not about that at all. And then he eventually changes his affections to see her more as a sister. So I just think it's an evolution of, you know, just from that initial attraction and flirtation to just appreciation for something more.
Yeah. Well, I was never big into shipping at all, and these two just like you said seemed more of a brother-sister type of relationship, friend relationship. I think that's when it works best, especially in later episodes. Some of the things that Sabine does for Ezra seem much more of a sisterly affection type of a thing than a romantic interest. So I'm glad they kind of steered away from that as soon as they did.
Me too. And it's also nice because not every boy-girl relationship of the same age needs to end up in a romance. And so I think it works, like you said, it works better as more of a family. And it makes more sense because that's exactly what the Ghost Crew is. They are a family.
Right. And on top of that, we kind of have this unspoken relationship. I feel like I'm quoting Guardians of the Galaxy here between Star-Lord and Gamora. But this unspoken thing that's going on between Kanan and Hera that we find out later is a very real thing. But their relationship is very subtly done. And I like that over the course of this. And we didn't need two couples in this one series. So
right.
I do like the way that this turned out. And ultimately, when we get to the conclusion of the series, I think it lends itself better for the potential future adventures of all these characters.
Well said.
So as they're making their getaway, Kanan's in the cockpit. And I guess he's the second most competent flyer there amongst the crew. And he's trying to figure out what to do about these Furnoxes. They're starting to jump on the ship. I love the way Hera just barges in to the cockpit and just leans right over him and starts flipping all the buttons, reroutes the power to the hull, fries that one Furnox that's crawling around in the cockpit right off. And she says something to the effect of like, you don't, there's a lot of things you don't know about my ship. And she really emphasizes the my and my ship. That, you know, that's part of her personality. As much as the Falcon is part of Han Solo's personality, the Ghost is part of Hera's.
Right. And it does, it harkens back to, I feel like, to the novel A New Dawn just a little bit. It has some feels of that as well. And Hera does call him dear at one point during the episode. I do remember as we were talking about their relationship. But yes, she is definitely very, very protective of the Ghost. And, you know, she should be.
All right. Well, that kind of gets us towards the end then, when ultimately they're safe. They've got the cargo that they went to get, or at least most of it. Hera is trying to reconcile a little bit with Sabine and kind of corners her before she's heading into a room and tells Sabine that we do trust you. I just trusted you with my life. However, the things that we are doing are for your safety, the safety of the rebellion. Sabine previously argued, you know, and shot back with her that when Hera said, look, if you don't know everything, then you can't give it up if you're captured. And Sabine said, what, you think I'd talk? And it's brave talk, but she's also still a teenager herself. Mm-hmm. And it's, you don't think you're going to, but what kind of pressure is the Empire going to put on you when it comes down to it? If they're holding someone you love and threatening them, you know, you may be able to stand the torture yourself, but are you going to remain tight-lipped to someone else or somebody else you hold dear is being tortured? But you can't give away secrets that you don't know. And Hera then promises Sabine, you know, we aren't always going to be alone in this fight. I promise you that. And we do trust you. And Sabine basically says that, you know, she appreciates that, she understands, and that she will try to trust them back. And frankly, at the time, I thought this was a storyline or a plot thread that we were going to be following for some time about Sabine having misgivings with the crew of the Ghost. And she might pull a Tam from Resistance and end up leaving them for a little while, but they kind of steered away from that pretty quickly.
They do. And you brought up a good point about the fact that Sabine is still a teenager. And a lot of times, you know, as parents of teenagers, we both know they want all the answers and they want them now. You know, it's the little Veruca Salt coming out in all of them. Mm-hmm. And they don't always see that bigger picture. And so they get frustrated. And sometimes they take out their anger, their frustrations in ways that are more targeted towards their loved ones. But, you know, sometimes too, we have to remember that that's also your safe place. You know, if you are going to have a breakdown, if you are going to be emotional, do it in your safe place. And so Hera is her safe place. The Ghost is the safe place. And so it's just got to be a matter of time before she realizes that. But you're right. It's kind of interesting that they didn't really pursue that. But yet, I think the episode does a good job of getting to that point and then showing through actions otherwise embedded into the series how it resolves itself. So it's not something that I think that they need to beat, you know, on the head every single episode. It's just kind of one of those things that evolves and happens.
Right. Especially since the Ezra and the dark side and the Force is something that they spend several episodes kind of teasing that this could have a bad outcome going. It's nice not to have to also worry about Sabine being a traitor at some point as well. So it's nice that they put that away. Well, that kind of brings us to the end of our discussion of this episode. I did want to touch on the Rebels Recon episode that's available on StarWars.com. And it's not so much for what it said about this episode. It's about what it said about the previous episode. And at the time, they were always taking social media questions from viewers on Twitter. And then Andy Gutierrez would track down Pablo Hidalgo and then ask him one of these questions. And so the question that she asked this time was about what was the Kyber crystal for that Empire had was transporting in the previous episode that Hera and Kanan blew up. And it's because this is an enormous crystal. And then Pablo speaks in vague but pointed terms about how, well, if you could imagine taking several of these large Kyber crystals and perhaps arranging them into a ring, that it might be able to refocus power in a really powerful way. And in the middle of this, there's a subliminal flash of the Death Star firing its primary weapon. And the thing is, I don't remember seeing that back in the day when I watched this episode of Rebels Recon. And so when I saw it here, I had to pause and back up a little bit. And I managed to pause it exactly on that moment. And I was like, oh, I didn't see that. That's pretty cool. So to the extent that there was any doubt about what the Empire is using the Kyber crystals for, there we go.
Huh, very nice. I'm going to have to go back and watch that one because subliminal message, yes.
Yeah,
maybe not so much.
Exactly. Well, before we wrap this one up, did you have any final thoughts?
I just think that this episode is good for setting things up in the future and also tying threads to things in the past, such as in the Clone Wars. So, you know, as we were just talking about with Sabine, it's just a great way to set that plot point out there. And then we also get those little breadcrumbs for Fulcrum. And again, we just see some more establishment of the characters themselves and just how they interact with each other in the Ghost and their relationships with each other as well. So, I mean, that's pretty much it for me. I think it was a good episode overall, and I liked to seeing Sabine and Hera work together. And like you said, seeing Hera get a lot more screen time.
Yeah, definitely. And I got to say, I keep saying this at the end of each one of these episodes, but I liked them at the time, and I really, really love them now. And it's fun to see these episodes and knowing where everything is going to go and just kind of how they built up these characters and the characters evolved over the course of the series. They all have character arcs. And we didn't realize what they were doing necessarily early on, but there are payoffs with each one of these episodes that show up later in the season or later in the series. So again, well done by the crew over there at Lucasfilm Animation. All right, well, that will bring us then to the end of this episode. I'd like to thank you all for listening to another episode of Podcast Stardust in our discussion of Episode 7 of Season 1 of Rebels, Out of Darkness. We are, of course, part of the RetroZap Podcast Network, and you can find all episodes of Podcast Stardust over on RetroZap.com. You can also subscribe to Podcast Stardust on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Overcast, Google Podcasts, or wherever it is that you listen to your shows, including the RetroZap podcast feed. If you've enjoyed the show, there are a few things you can do to help us grow. First, spread the word about Podcast Stardust on social media and make sure to tag us when you do. Also, please consider heading over to Apple Podcasts and leaving us a 5-star rating and a brief review about what it is that you like about Podcast Stardust. With that being said, Jay, can you remind everyone one more time where they can find us on social media and around the internet?
Absolutely. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. If you'd like to reach out to Dennis on Twitter, he is at DJKVER2, and I'm at Joyce Krebs. We also have a Pinterest page and a YouTube channel, and you can also email us your thoughts at podcaststardust@retrozap.com. And if email is not your thing, you can also join us on our Discord room on the RetroZap Discord server. And we're over there having all kinds of great conversations. We're talking a lot about books right now, which is awesome. So if you'd like to join us over there, just go to our show page, click on the community tab, and it'll take you right where you need to go. And we are also on TeePublic, where you can find all kinds of Podcast Stardust logos with stickers and t-shirts and sweatshirts and coffee mugs and mouse pads and you name it, it's over there. And that is tpublic.com/user/podcaststardust. And thanks to Corey Club from Coffee with Kenobi for producing all of those great designs.
All right, then. Well, that'll do it for episode 122 of Podcast Stardust. Thanks for listening, everyone. And until next time, may the Force be with you.